Hello everyone, today we will discuss about the lacrimal apparatus of the head and neck topic. First of all, these all five components actually constitute the lacrimal apparatus, that is the lacrimal gland and its ducts, conjunctival sac, lacrimal puncture and canaliculi, lacrimal sac and the nasolacrimal duct. So all these five components actually forms the lacrimal apparatus. Now let's discuss some of the main things in short, so it will be easier for you to understand all these things in detail. Now first of all, this is the lacrimal gland and this is the ducts of the lacrimal gland. Now conjunctival sac, what is it? It is actually a space in between this eyelid and the conjunctiva of the eye. Okay, so the space in between, very small space you can see, is the space between the tooth, maybe the conjunctiva and the eyelid in short. Okay. Now, the lacrimal puncture is actually the holes over here, small two holes you can see from outside also in this medial part of the eye. This is the medial part of the eye, okay, and this is the ear part. So, over here you will see small lacrimal puncture. I am just discussing this in short, so whenever this all these words will come in between all these explanations, it will be easier for you to locate that where that particular thing is present. Now these are some SI lacrimal glands, we'll talk about this. This is the lacrimal puncture. This is the lacrimal canaliculi. These two canals are known as the lacrimal canaliculi, which are going from the lacrimal puncture. Okay. Now these lacrimal canaliculi will actually drain into lacrimal sac. This is the lacrimal sac. And then this is the nasolacrimal duct, which will actually open finally into your nasal cavity. So that's why we can consider that whenever your eyes are running, or we can say tears come out of your eyes, because of this duct, because of this connection between your eyes and the nose, your nose also starts running. Okay. And fornix, what is fornix? We have mainly two types of conjunctival fornix. Okay. Conjunctival fornix are of two types, superior and inferior. Okay. Just remember what is it, we'll discuss about this in detail later. It is just a line which actually connects the lids part and the conjunctiva. Okay, in a very simple words, it is just a line. Okay, when you will just pull your eyes down or the upper eyelids up, so whatever line you see will actually connect the conjunctiva and this skinny part. Okay, the line which connects these two is known as the conjunctival fornix. Okay, if it is in the upper part, so it will be superior conjunctival fornix. And if it is in the inferior part or lower eye, it will be inferior conjunctival fornix. Now, first of all, lacrimal gland. It is actually a serous gland which actually produces the lacrimal fluid. And it is situated mainly in the lacrimal fossa, somewhere over here. In the lacrimal fossa on the anterolateral part of the bony orbit and partly on your eyelids as well. Okay. Now small accessory lacrimal gland over here, as you can see this somewhere over here. Okay. The small accessory lacrimal gland, which are also known as the cross gland. Okay. They are present in the conjunctival fornix. I told you what is conjunctival fornix. They are the line over here. Whenever it is visible from outside as well. Whenever you will pull your lower eyelid down, so you will see one line which actually connects the conjunctiva of your eye and the skinny part of your this eyelids. So that line is known as the fornix. Okay, so but this accessory lacrimal gland is actually present only on the superior conjunctival fornix, not on the inferior conjunctival fornix. So remember, the location of the cross gland is the conjunctival fornix, that is superior one only. Now, this gland actually, lacrimal gland is actually indented by the LPS, that is the levator palpebrae superioris. This is, I told you in my muscle of the face, that LPS is actually an extraocular muscle which is supplied by the 7th cranial nerve. So it is indented by that, and this gland is actually J in shape and has mainly two parts. That is the orbital part, which is present on the I told you before its location. Its location is on the roof of the bony orbit and upper eyelid. So it has mainly two parts. That is the orbital part and the palpebral part. Now about the lacrimal ducts. About a dozen of the lacrimal ducts actually pierces the conjunctiva of the upper eyelid and opens into the conjunctival sac near the superior fornix. So what they will do? These ducts actually will pierce the conjunctiva of the eye and they will open into the superior conjunctival fornix and will drain into conjunctival sac. So now you know what is superior conjunctival fornix. What is conjunctival sac? I told you before, it is a space between your conjunctiva and your both eyelids. Whatever space, okay, whenever you will pull your eye, whatever the space is between your conjunctiva and the eyelids is the conjunctival sac. So this duct will actually pierce the conjunctiva and open into the superior conjunctival fornix and will drain into conjunctival sac. Okay, now most of the ducts of the orbital part passes through the palpebral part. What is the palpable part? Palpable part is this part, that is the eyelid part is the palpable part also. Okay, so some of the ducts actually pierces the palpable part. Till now it was piercing the conjunctiva and opening into superior conjunctival fornix. But some of the orbital ducts will actually pierce the palpable part. That means this eyelid inner part. Eyelids inner part is known as the palpable part. Okay, so they will pierce that and finally drain into conjunctival sac. So if I will remove the later, that means this palpable part, so it is almost equivalent to the removal of the entire gland only. So after removal, the conjunctiva and the cornea are actually moistened by the accessory lacrimal gland. So if I will remove the palpable parts duct supplying, so if I will remove the ducts which are supplying the palpable part, that means this removal of this palpable part will actually result in the same as removal of the lacrimal gland. So the lacrimal gland will no in use further. So then accessory lacrimal gland will function in moistening of the eye. Now the lacrimal gland is actually supplied by one artery and one nerve of the same name. There is a lacrimal artery and lacrimal nerve. Lacrimal branch of ophthalmic artery. Okay, lacrimal branch of ophthalmic artery. This lacrimal artery actually branch of ophthalmic artery. And remember, ophthalmic artery is further a branch of internal carotid artery. Okay, lacrimal artery is a branch of ophthalmic artery, and ophthalmic artery is further a branch of the internal carotid artery and further the lacrimal nerve. And the nerve has both sensory and the secretomotor fiber. So whenever that, why? Because whenever any kind of dust particle, any kind of other foreign particle actually enters in your eye, so this nerve actually senses by the sensory part, and by the secretomotor part it will secrete the lacrimal fluid, the tears. The lacrimal fluid secreted by the lacrimal gland flows into the conjunctival sac, where it lubricates the front of the eye and keeps the deep surface of the eyelids moistened. Periodic blinking helps to spread the fluid all over the eye, because these ducts are actually opening into the conjunctival fornix only. Okay, superior conjunctival fornix, or we can see the palpable part. Okay, but how the whole fluid is actually able to spread into the whole eye, so it is because just of the blinking of the eye. So that's why you continuously blink. Now most of the fluid actually evaporates and the rest is actually drained by this lacrimal canaliculi. Okay, so most evaporate and most is actually drained by this canaliculi, which will enter ultimately into your nasal cavity. Okay, when excess fluid occurs, so it will cause tears formation. Now the conjunctival sac. Now I told you before, this conjunctival sac. Conjunctival sac is actually those part of the eye. See over here, as you can see. If I will pull the eye, okay, there is a space in between the pulp, this eyelid part and the conjunctival part of the eye. So the space between these two is known as a conjunctival sac, as the name says, sac. Now the conjunctival line, the deep surfaces of the eyelids, is known as the palpable conjunctiva. Means this part, means the conjunctival lining the deep surfaces of the eyelids, is known as a palpable conjunctiva. And the lining of the front of the eyeball is known as the bulbar conjunctiva. Means this part which is actually covered by the eyelid is known as a bulbar conjunctiva. And this part एक्चुअली इज इन कॉन्टैक्ट विद द आई लीड और द कंजक्टिवा इज नोन एज द बल्बर सॉरी पाल्पेबल कंजक्टिवा. सो दिस पार्ट इज द पाल्पेबल कंजक्टिवा, जस्ट रिमेंबर दिस पार्ट. एंड द कंजक्टिवल पार्ट विच इज कवर्ड बाय द आई लीड इज नोन एज द बल्बर कंजक्टिवा. सो डोंट कन्फ्यूज बिटवीन दीज टू थिंग्स. मोस्टली पीपल गेट कन्फ्यूज बिटवीन बल्बर कंजक्टिवा एंड द पाल्पेबल कंजक्टिवा. पाल्पेबल कंजक्टिवा इज that part okay which is actually which actually covers this part, while the bulbar conjunctiva is those part which is actually covered by this part. So this is palpable, this is bulbar, and conjunctival sac is the space between these two things. We can consider that these two, between these two things, these two conjunctiva, there is the space known as a conjunctival sac in short. Now the superior and the inferior conjunctival fornix, these two things are the two types of the conjunctival fornix. I told you before that the lines along with the palpebral conjunctiva, this one of the upper and the lower eyelid, is actually reflected onto the eyeball. Means this part, this line, is actually part of the palpebral conjunctiva, okay, which is actually making this part in contact with the eyeball. Okay, this part is known as the fornix. Okay, this is this line which actually connects the palpebral and the bulbar part is the fornix. Okay, this inferior and the up, in the upper one there will be superior. Now the palpebral conjunctiva is actually thick, opaque, highly vascular and adherent to the tarsal plate, this part and this part, and this will also have tarsal gland as well. Okay, this palpebral part. Okay, the bulbar part covers the sclera. It is thin, transparent and loosely attached to the eyeball. Over the cornea, it is presented by the anterior epithelium of the cornea. Now, next is the lacrimal puncta and canaliculi. I told you before, these two holes over here. Okay, you can just go in front of the mirror and just look into your eye. Over here in the medial part, okay, you will see two holes, two big holes like something. These are the lacrimal puncta. Okay, and from this lacrimal puncta, there are two canaliculi going from it, okay, which actually drains the excess lacrimal fluid and will drain this into the corresponding lacrimal sac. Okay, so lacrimal canaliculi begins at the lacrimal puncta and is around 10 mm long. It has a vertical part which is 2 mm long and horizontal part which is 8 mm long. Okay, now there is dilated ampulla at the bend. When it is bended, there is an ampulla. Okay, both canaliculi open close to each other in the lateral wall of the lacrimal sac behind the medial palpebral ligament. Means in front of these things, there will be medial palpebral ligament. So this canaliculi is actually open into the lateral part of this lacrimal sac, in the lateral part of this and behind the medial palpebral ligament. Now the lacrimal sac is this part, okay, which actually drains whatever the fluid comes from the lacrimal canaliculus. Now it is membranous sac, 12 mm long and 5 mm wide. It is mainly situated in the lacrimal groove behind the medial palpebral ligament. So it is also behind the medial palpebral ligament and present in the lacrimal groove. Remember, this lacrimal sac is present on the lacrimal groove, while the lacrimal gland is present on the lacrimal fossa. Its upper end is bare, as you can see. Of course, there is no connection of any kind of other duct from its upper part. It is blind completely. The lower part is continuous with the nasolacrimal duct. This is the nasolacrimal duct. This sac and this is the duct. Okay, and the sac is related anteriorly to the medial palpebral ligament. Okay, I told you before, they're in front of this canaliculus and this lacrimal sac, there will be medial palpebral ligament. And this, remember, this lacrimal sac is present in the lacrimal groove. Anteriorly, the relation of this lacrimal sac is the medial palpebral ligament and to the orbicularis oculi muscles. Okay, these two things. Medially, the lacrimal groove separates it from the nose. Medially, there will be lacrimal. Somewhere over here, there will be lacrimal groove. Laterally, it is related to the lacrimal fascia and the lacrimal part of the orbicularis oculi. Okay, orbicularis oculi lacrimal part and the lacrimal fascia. So medially there would be lacrimal groove. Laterally there will be orbicularis oculi lacrimal part and the lacrimal fascia. In the anterior part there will be two things, orbicularis oculi muscle and the medial palpebral ligament. Now the nasolacrimal duct, it is actually a membranous passage. This is a nasolacrimal duct, 18 mm long. It begins at the lower end of the lacrimal sac and runs downwards, backwards and laterally. Remember, it runs downwards, backwards and laterally and opens into the inferior meatus of the nose. And remember, a fold of the mucous membrane called as the wall of Hessner. This is the wall of Hessner. It actually forms an imperfect wall at the lower end of the duct. Okay, this is the Hessner wall. Just remember the wall of this, important for MCQ purpose. Okay, so in short, let's discuss it later. This is the lacrimal gland, then lacrimal duct, then these two are the lacrimal puncta, the lacrimal canaliculi. The space between the bulbar conjunctiva and the palpebral conjunctiva is the conjunctival sac. Then from these puncta, two canaliculus, lacrimal canaliculus. Then this is the lacrimal sac, and from this, nasolacrimal duct, then the Hessner wall, and then finally into the nasal cavity. This is the reason why when a lot excess water comes into our eyes, because of that our nose also starts running, because whatever the excess water is present into our eye is actually drained by this canaliculus and then it actually comes into our nasal cavity ultimately. Now the clinical aspects, first of all, we have dacrocystasis. What is this? This is the inflammation of the lacrimal sac. This is the lacrimal sac. So whatever, if the any kind of inflammation occurred, this is known as the dacrocystasis. Now the duct of the lacrimal gland actually opens through its palpable part into the conjunctival sac. I told you before that two ways are there. Okay, the duct actually open into the conjunctival sac by two ways. Either they will actually pierce the superior fornix and open into the conjunctival sac, or either they will pierce the palpable part of the eye or the palpable conjunctiva. So the duct of the lacrimal gland open through the palpable conjunctiva and the conjunctival sac. Because of this arrangement, the removal of the palpable part necessitates the removal of the orbital part as well. So I told you before, if I will remove this part, so it will be equivalent to the removal of the lacrimal gland also. Okay, so then the cross gland or the accessory lacrimal gland will come into function. Now the epiphorea, excessive secretion of the lacrimal fluid or the tear overflowing on the cheeks is known as the epiphorea. Epiphorea may result due to the obstruction in the lacrimal fluid pathway either at the level of the punctum or the canaliculi or the nasolacrimal duct. So in short, epiphorea may result due to the obstruction of the lacrimal fluid pathway either at the three places, either in the punctum, that means these two holes, either in these two holes there is obstruction, or at the canaliculus part, or in the nasolacrimal duct. Okay, so let's remember the three clinical aspects were very easy. Dacrocystasis, removal of the palpable part of the conjunctiva is almost equivalent to the removal of the orbital part of the lacrimal gland, and the epiphorea. So this was all about the lacrimal apparatus, its component and its clinical aspects. So hope you understood it well. Thank you so much.